Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, though I walk through the wilderness. Sorry, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Please take a seat. Brad, you're up.
Now, normally, well, not normally, but it used to be back in the olden days that right after this part, we would all go around and shake hands with each other. So this morning, I want you to make eye contact with somebody you haven't spoken to yet this morning and wave at them. And at least let, Richard, I see that hand. I see those hands. I see that hand. Make contact with somebody in the eyeballs that you haven't seen. Wave at them and greet them. At least, hey, good morning. Morning, Jordan. Okay, if I could draw your attention to some announcements in the bulletin at this point, that would be great. If you've got your bulletin, you can get that out. Josh came up to me before the service and said, if you could let people know that we're reaching the, we're getting kind of desperate phase in looking for volunteers to help with the junior high youth group. So soon, like right now, if you would like to volunteer, if you have a heart for ministry, there may be some incentives offered, donuts. I mean, who knows what Josh is willing to offer for the volunteers because they're reaching the desperation phase. But really, seriously, if you've got a heart for ministry and you want to impact young people for the Lord, please contact Josh. The good news is we need more volunteers. That means we've got more students and young people coming, which is a wonderful thing. The drive-through trunk or treat's going to be happening on the 31st from 5:30 to 6:30. There is a sign-up sheet and a candy donation box at the Welcome Center. Just saying, a Reese's cup wouldn't kill me. That's all I'm going to say. So that's happening on the 31st from 5:30 to 6:30. The quarterly business meeting is going to be Sunday after the service on the 25th. It's going to be a really busy weekend that weekend because the new members class actually, it says next, is that next week? Is the 23rd through the 24th next week? It's not. But anyway, all the information you need is right there if you're a new member considering joining the church. It's the 23rd through the 24th at the McCormick House, Friday and Saturday. It's got the times right there. Breakfast is provided on Saturday, just so you know. Breakfast is provided. There's some other information in there in your bulletin. Please peruse that. Draw your attention to that. Are there any that I've missed? Any announcements that... Okay, Sunny, would you like to come up and pray?
Please join me in prayer. Blessed Heavenly Father, we just bless your name, Lord, and we know that your name is above all other names, that, you take care of us, watch over us, and have all power in the universe and over all events that happen, Lord. We just ask you to continue to bless this congregation, Lord. Lord, raise up more workers to that we may share your gospel throughout this community and around the world, Lord. Dear Lord, we just ask you to bless the remainder of the service, be with the pastor as he brings the message today, Lord, and have our hearts and minds open to your leading, Lord. Lord, we just, again, bless you and praise your name, Lord, and we ask that you be with the remainder of the service and this congregation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So please stand with us again and we'll continue with some more singing. Oh, I better turn on. How sweet the sound, amazing love now flowing down from hands and feet. They were nailed to the tree as grace flows down and covers me. It covers me. It covers me. Covers me. It covers me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and they were nailed to the tree as grace flows down and covers me. It covers me. It covers me. It covers me. It covers me. Cover me.
cover me. And cover me.
Where your love
my sin washed white. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless. My heart has peace with God and forgiveness. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender. My life, I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. Here my hope is found. Here on holy ground. Here I bow. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red, my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus.
Amen. Please have a seat.
Wow. Thank you. Such a great song and perfect song as really an intro to today's message. I had thought as we were singing some of that I might find a way to read some of it back to you, but I'm just going to let those words settle. There's one line that really gripped me this morning, and that was, there's a place where sin and shame lose their power, or something like that. And at the cross, near to him, he ran red that we might be clothed in white. And today's message is from Isaiah chapter 53. And, really one of the most precious chapters in all of God's Word, Old and New Testament. And in Isaiah, there are two chapters in Isaiah that I come to a bit trembling. Because of the holiness, because of the implications of what God has said, what he's doing, what he's saying about what he's doing. The first of those was Isaiah 6. You know where it says, in the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. And it is filled with the glory and the majesty and the wonder, this revelation of God that Isaiah was able to see. And it's beyond human description, but Isaiah attempts to put it into words. And I come to it always with just a sense of, I really even need the portion in that chapter where Isaiah confesses his sin and God forgives him, because the holy nature of that chapter just always makes me feel so unclean. And I come trembling. And then here in chapter 53, the fact that it is interwoven with the suffering and the sacrifice of Messiah on our behalf, it is interwoven with the effect of that, which is our salvation for those who believe, that it is a little less trembling here, but nonetheless, we are confronted with the magnitude of our sin, because that's what caused and required the magnitude of his suffering. And yes, it's our fault. It's not just those in the first century, not just the Roman soldiers, not just the hypocritical religious people of the day. It's each and every one of us. If you were the only person alive, or there's ever even been, your sin would require, in order for it to be atoned and forgiven, set aside by Almighty God, it would require the cross. So today's message is the Savior's sacrifice. We recently saw the Savior's obedience, and this was what his obedience was unto death, and even death on a cross. This section actually begins in chapter 52, okay? So all the supported texts are going to be on the screens, but I want you to be in your Bibles, in your devices, whatever it is you have, when we look at the primary text, which today is going to be Isaiah 52, beginning at verse 13, and I'm going to read through to the end of chapter 53. Father in heaven, Lord God, as we look into your word, as we read this small portion of it, small but packed with power, because it's packed with the essential truths of the gospel. Father, help us to hear it. Help us to even to feel it appropriately in it. And perhaps most importantly, to respond to it in a way that would be pleasing in your sight. I ask in Jesus' name. Chapter 52, verse 13. Behold, my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. Just as many were astonished at you, my people, so his appearance was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Thus he will sprinkle many nations. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. For what had not been told them, they will see. And what they had not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due? His grave was assigned with wicked men, and yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of his Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sins of many and interceded for the transgressors. Father in heaven, again, thank you for the reality of what you're laying down here. Much of it was hundreds of years in the future to be fulfilled through Jesus. And some of it, the completion of the salvation upon your return for those who believe, remains yet in the future. But it's all laid down here. Your plan that didn't come into motion as Isaiah was writing this, or even first speaking it, but infinitely long before that, your plan to act upon your love that required you, demanded this sacrifice. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay, so this section in Isaiah really lays down with clarity the importance of the cross. You know, we think of the cross, as, you know, we think of the New Testament, we think of all of the Gospels that are written, and they picture that unfolding of history when Almighty God was born and grew and came to die for us, and we read the crucifixion story. But it is foreshadowed, prophesied, even initiated here in this section, the importance of the cross. You know, it's one thing for, you know, Jesus to be called the light of the nations. That was just back in chapter 49. He was the light of the nations, and there's hope in that. And then another where he is, you know, in chapter 50, he was the obedient servant, the obedient Savior, an obedient and foreshadowing suffering. But even then, it's not yet complete, still remained the question. And I'm going to read this twice because this is the mingling of what is happening here in chapter 53. The question that remains, as we come to chapter 43, is how could God possibly deliver us from the eternal consequences of our sin and guilt while at the same time maintaining his own unblemished holiness that demands judgment? That was really the conundrum or the situation, the dilemma. There's never a dilemma to God, but this conflicting ideals that only in God's infinite wisdom is complete and met in the cross. Again, how could God possibly deliver us from the eternal consequences of our sin and guilt while at the same time maintaining his own unblemished holiness that demands judgment? These verses that I just read are God's perfect and costly answer. His perfect and costly answer. Look at chapter 52, verse 13. "Behold, my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted." The final verses of Isaiah 52 really contain the entire sweep of truth from his humiliation to resurrection and exaltation, all the way through to the climactic moment when the rulers of the world would unexpectedly be confronted with the glory of who Jesus is. The whole scope in these future verses. When he returns, the contrast between his severe disfigurement, because remember how that's described here, to where he's unrecognizable as a man. So the contrast between his severe disfigurement on the cross and the glory of his majesty when he returns, there will be shock and amazement, and particularly upon the leaders of the earth. It will be the genuine shock and awe when Almighty God, Jesus, returns in glory and majesty. Verses 14, 15. "Just as many were astonished at you, my people, so his appearance was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men." Now think about that for a moment. In other words, really what he is saying is he was beaten and marred more than they had done to any other person ever. You know, a lot of times we use, you know, kind of over the top language, right? Like the best, the greatest, the most, and here it's marred more than any man, in his form more than the sons of men. It had never been seen before when someone who had been so severely and ruthlessly and repeatedly beaten and whipped, scourged, more than any other person. And it says his appearance more than any other man. So I kind of think of his face. And then his form more than the sons of men. So I mean, just of all the rest of the people. So if you've seen, you know, Mel Gibson's Passion, one of the things some said about that was, here's Mel Gibson again, you know, going off into gratuitous violence and graphic displays. No, he didn't. I know that for a fact because Jim Caviezel was the actor that played Jesus. And even at the most disfigured as they made him with makeup, I could still recognize the actor Jim Caviezel. What actually happened was worse yet even than Gibson was able to display on film. Yet, one of the most moving and troubling and stunning things that I have ever witnessed was to watch those scenes in that film. In the theater, when it had first come out, his appearance is marred more than any man, his form more than the sons of men. Verse 15, thus he will sprinkle many nations. There will be healing. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. For what had not been told them, they will see. What they had not heard, they will understand. When he returns, he goes out looking like this. He returns looking more like the description we see of John's in the book of Revelation. That revelation of Jesus, the one where he's trying to describe it, and it's the power, the glory, the majesty, the wonder, the beauty, the radiance, the everything is beyond description. That's what he will be when he returns, and the kings of the earth will shut their mouths on account of him. They will be in shock and amazement. He was marred beyond description. In addition to the flogging that he received, listen further as we do go into the Gospels a bit, that what they had already done before the crucifixion was beaten with rods and fists, the ripping of his face, his beard, and his eyes. Matthew 26, Isaiah 53. Savior's sacrifice. Matthew 26, verse 67. Then they spat in his face and beat him with their fists, and others slapped him. Chapter 27, 29 to 30. And after twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they knelt down before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him and took the reed and began to beat him on the head. John chapter 19, verse 3, and they began to come up to him and say, "Hail, King of the Jews," and to give him slaps on his face. Turn back just to chapter 50 and verse 6. It was a bit of a foreshadow of this that we find there. In chapter 50, verse 6, it says, "I gave my back to those who strike me, and my cheeks to those who pluck out my beard. I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting." He took it all for us. And truly, you know, as Jesus says, This is your hour and the power of darkness. Driven by Satan himself, the vilest of human beings and human evil crushed his life and appearance. Look at this in Luke chapter 22, 52 and 53. Then Jesus said to the chief priests and officers of the temple and elders who had come against him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as you would against a robber? While I was with you daily in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But look, but this hour and the power of darkness are yours." You know, I got to say that prior to studying through this here again afresh this week and weeks, I had seen or you know, really comprehended that last phrase. It says, I've been with you all this time. You could have just come and got me at any time and place. Why now in the middle of the night, and as if I'm, you know, just some common criminal, and you're doing this all clandestine and with all this conspiracy and all of this deceit? And but this hour and the power of darkness are yours, he says. This time has been set aside. The Father and I and the Holy Spirit, we've set it aside. Time and all of time and hours and all of power is mine, would say the Lord. But this hour, you will have your way. All of your the evil contemplated in your wicked hearts will have opportunity to express itself. Because how more wickedly and viciously to take a man who is love incarnate, creator and sustainer of every one of his enemies, and to take that one and do unto him what they did. And again, it would be one thing to take him straight away, place him lying over a cross member beams of timbers, and nail him through the wrists and the ankles. And as excruciating as that is, and that whole process, as well as how you die from crucifixion, usually through suffocation, shock, blood loss, all manner of things, though that may have been the very worst of all of the suffering, what they did for maybe hours and hours preceding, people taking opportunity to beat and whip. And whip, you remember, with those types of whips that were leather straps intertwined with shards of clay and other, you know, very sharp objects that would rip away the skin off of the back, exposing the muscle and other tissues. To a person who just loves them, has only done good things and miracles and fed people and loved people, and in doing this right now to set you free eternally from sin and shame and guilt, and you know, again, it'd be one thing, you know, for, because sometimes awful people are apprehended. And particularly like in third world nations, maybe a former ruler or some bad guy. And what do they do to him? They beat him up. They drag him through the streets. You know, like, you know, William Wallace, they you know, they tied his four limbs to four horses, and then they slapped the horses, and he was drawn and quartered. He was ripped in pieces. And they cut his head off and displayed that in the four. And, you know, people can do really horrific things to people that they deem to be just the most wicked enemy. This is the love of the universe before them, and people, there's that degree of wickedness and evil that they would take opportunity, and not just a few people, but many people along the way, and then all of the rest, many cheering them on, to do this to such a one as him. This is your hour, Jesus said. The power of darkness are yours. But just for a moment, just for these moments, leading up to the crucifixion, after the crucifixion, the burial, but then come Sunday morning, at least by then, no later than, your hour is over, and I am back in unexpressible victory. So then the next time the world sees them, see, that's in here as well, you know, in verse 13, he's going to be exalted. The world will respond to him the next time they see him. Matthew 24:30, and then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. I Revelation 1:7, behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. So it is to be. Amen. And also in Revelation chapter 6, verses 14 and following, the sky was split apart like a scroll when it's rolled up, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. Then the kings of the earth and the great men and the commanders and the rich and the strong and every slave and free man hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains, still feeling the weight of their shame and guilt. And I must run away from this man who convicts me of my sin. But he is also the one who offers forgiveness from our sins. Continuing on, verse 16 and 17. And they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand? Wow. You know, there's a great sense with a lot of those who were there contemporaneously with Jesus as he's being killed upon the cross, that they didn't get it. They didn't know who he was. They would say, we didn't know who you were. So in the chapter 53, remember John says about them, you know, he came to his own and those who were his own did not receive him. They didn't know who he was. You know when Jesus says on the cross, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do? You know why that is, just for me, just rings so incredibly true. Okay, I mean, sometimes you can read things that God says and it's like, I don't understand it, I don't get it, help me here. But with that one, I say, you know, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Of course they didn't know what they were doing. Had they really known what they were doing, that this one they're crucifying is the one who's come to die for them in their place because he loves them and to give them life abundant, they didn't know what they were doing. Now, still guilty and culpable because they allowed their own sin and that hatred and that fear and all of that to drive what they were doing, but they did not know what they were doing. Ultimately, meaning they did not know that Jesus was indeed Almighty God, creator of the universe, and the one who's come because he loves them and he's come to set them free. They didn't know what they were doing. It says, Lord, please have mercy on us. We not only ignored you when you came, we despised you. So I'm gonna read kind of a paraphrase and then the verse. Okay? So, Lord, please have mercy on us. We not only ignored you, and when you came, we despised you. 53, verses 1 to 3. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Then maybe they go on and they say, you know, in fact, when we shouted, crucify him, crucify him, we thought you were a blasphemer and God was giving you what you deserved. Look at verse 4. Surely, now again, this is Isaiah's perspective of being able to be in both places, right? The before not knowing who Jesus is and clearly knowing who Jesus is. So verse 4, surely our griefs he himself bore and our sorrows he carried. But look at the rest. Yet we ourselves... He said, you know, the truth is the surely he bore our griefs. Okay? But they're saying, but yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. They esteemed him, that is, they assessed the situation to be God is doing this. The Father, Almighty God, is destroying this blasphemer. They didn't get it. We ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, you God, and afflicted. Verse 7, something like, you know, we thought if you were innocent, you would have defended yourself, but you didn't. Look at verse 7. He was oppressed and it was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, he did not open his mouth. He did not defend himself. For he's doing what he's doing willingly is difficult and is with incomprehensible anguish. He is doing this willingly. We thought you would have defended yourself, but you didn't. And in verse 8, it's something like, you know, we didn't know. He says in verse 8, this, as for his generation, you know, who considered, and you know, the that which is true. We didn't get it. As for his generation, who considered? Lord, we didn't know. We didn't know who you were. Had we only realized this. Now let me read verses 4 through 8. If we had realized this, surely our griefs he himself bore and our sorrows he carried, yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging we are healed. And all of us like sheep have gone astray, and each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living? For the transgression of my people, for whom the stroke was due. We didn't know who you were. Today, lots and lots of people who don't know who he is. It could possibly be any one of us in this room. But the good news is that we can respond to his revelation that he is who he says he is. And he did what he said he was going to do. And he did it because he loves you. And we can say, God, forgive me indeed that I know not what I do. I do not know. I have not known who you are. I have esteemed you low. I have not esteemed you for who you really are. And be born again. And perhaps it's a, you know, I think at least for Isaiah, this might have been a promise or things that were too great for him to grasp. You know, that truth that God the Son would step into history, take on weak, pitiful humanity, become the Father's sacrificial lamb was likely too much for Isaiah to grasp. What about for us? Can we wrap our minds around this, that the absoluteness of God's holiness and the motivation of God's love? Let me read this as a further statement. Are we really able to wrap our minds around both the absoluteness of God's holiness and the motivation of God's love to the degree, you know, that we read again here, in 53:10, but the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. pleased? Really? See, that's what I mean about being able to wrap our minds around the absoluteness of God's holiness and the drivenness, the motivation of his love towards those he created that would take him to that. We could even say, we could say all that and it would take him to the cross. But here, I'm having us pause at what precedes the cross, that the Father, the Lord, Yahweh, was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. How can it be? Pleased, really? You know, maybe we should go with, you know, the ESV or the NIV. Two popular translations, and they translate this, but the Lord, it was the Lord's will to crush him. But no. The Hebrew word here really does mean pleased. And it's very inconsistent to translate it God's will, because it's not translated that anywhere else. Every now and then there are truths in Scripture that translators can't come to terms with. There's one, you know, there's a very common one where it says that God created man a little lower than the angels, or a little lower than God. Well, the Hebrew Scripture clearly says he created man a little lower than Elohim, God. But the translators had trouble with that. Seriously? He created us a little lower than himself? And so they kind of did this thing to where they kind of, well, you know, maybe Elohim here means some godly expression. Maybe it's angels. And so he made people a little lower than the angels. But no, he didn't. Because Scripture says in the end, people will judge angels. We will stand and judge over angels. And so sometimes Scripture is difficult, but we got to deal with it at face value. What does it mean that God created man a little lower than God, than himself? Meaning that we're created in his image? We are really the next most amazing and precious thing in the universe? Now, we know from the rest of Scripture that we're not a little lower in the sense of, you know, just the reality of our being, okay? Power, ability, all of that. There's infinite separation. A little lower in the sense of which we're created in his image. And he is right there. We are the ones in which he wants to have relationship with. That's why Isaiah 53, that's why the cross. And so translate it like it reads and let us try and figure it out. Same thing here. Wait a minute. It pleased Yahweh to crush Jesus? Yikes. Well, clearly he did it, and so we know it's according to his will. So let's translate it. It was the will of God to crush him, putting him to grief. But no. It doesn't get us there. It doesn't get us to the place where we've got to reconcile pleased in this context. It may be uncomfortable. I need to wrestle with it. What in the world does he mean, pleased? How can it be? But it can only be as we wrestle with the truth that apart from his immeasurable sacrifice by both the Father and Son, they would never be able to release their boundless love to a lost and sinful world. And so it's this, in other words. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. For God so loves you, and it pleased him to love you, and it pleases him to receive relationship, your love, for you to receive his forgiveness and be united with him. It pleases God so much. For God so loved the world, that pleases him so much to get to you that it pleased him to do that which got him there. You follow me? And what that does again is it magnifies what it got him to. Remember we talked a couple weeks ago that where the writer of Hebrews says, for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. What was the joy set before him? Now, not everyone universally believes it's you and me, but every now and then there's an obscure thing that someone might suggest. But I really believe it's nothing but the fact that on the other side of the cross was accomplishing the purpose of the cross, to redeem all those who would believe. And so for the joy set before him, he's going into, trust me folks, as a full human being, though fully God, he's going to the cross with all the same anguish and fear and horror that you and I would. But he said, but for the joy set before me, I endured the cross. For the joy set before me, for the Father so loved the world, and it so pleased him that it pleased him to do that which got him there. He would never have been able to release the boundless love to a lost and sinful world. And see, his own holiness demanded such a sacrifice. Because remember we said earlier, how could God possibly deliver us from the eternal consequences of our sin and guilt, while at the same time maintaining his own unblemished holiness that demands judgment? It's the cross. Because it satisfies the judgment. Jesus took it. In your place, in yours and mine. Substitutionary. And it satisfied. And yet he is holy and he remains holy, though the sins of the world were placed upon an innocent man, an innocent God. But he paid it in our place. The penalty must be paid. His righteousness, his holiness demands it. And so this marvelous plan of salvation, the cross, was put into place. This, and the reason oftentimes it seems so crazy, really, that God himself would be born a human and suffer and die and be mistreated and all of the things that happen. If we really just kind of look at that, we go, really? That's a God story? I thought the God stories were, you know, all those glorious stories. And the reason it's so peculiar is because the plan was satisfied out of the infinite mind of God that simultaneously satisfied his holiness, both of his own and the holiness requirement of us, and that the penalty must be paid because we are far from holy, and the only way we become holy, set apart unto God, is through his suffering, death, blood, resurrection, and life. So therefore, we state it this way perhaps. Since it is God's pleasure to love us, it must first have been his pleasure to crush his own beloved Son. And for that reason, Jesus opened not his mouth, we read. And he didn't say a word. He didn't want to do anything to lessen the full extent of his own crushing agony and suffering. Okay, and then finally, substitution and divine satisfaction. Really, we have a verse here in Isaiah chapter 53 that perhaps is good or maybe even better than anywhere in the New Testament, sums up God's saving work in a single verse. Verse 11. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, and he will bear their iniquities. There you have it. What he did satisfies. The Father sees it and is satisfied. He is the righteous one. He is the obedient servant. And he is justifying the many. See, through the death of one, many are justified. Justified, a legal term, meaning not guilty. The last part of the verse, and he will bear their iniquities, their sin. He bore it all. Okay, so there you have it. The gospel. Isaiah 53:11. And Jesus' last words before he died on the cross were, you know, it is finished. It is finished. John 19:30. Jesus said, it is finished. It's the word tetelestai. And it's a word from which we get, you know, all those things like, you know, telescope and all these things which are out in the distance. You can project out to the distance. It's bringing something to completion. And the interesting thing about this word as well is that in contemporary documents, the same time that this is going on, in the New Testament era, the debts that were owed, when they were paid in full, they were stamped with tetelestai. Isn't that cool? It said, boom, paid in full. Tetelestai. Really, the most literal translation is, it is finished. Okay? Jesus spoke the word tetelestai. One word. Most accurately translated into our language, it is finished. Also representing that which is paid in full. Thank you, Lord. And paralleling this victorious dying shout must be those words from Isaiah where he says, he shall see and be satisfied. Isn't it the same thing? The Father sees and is satisfied. It's accomplished. It's finished. So now, his boundless love can flow. The barrier of sin and death has been broken down. Christ has become the propitiation for our sins. Propitiation, not a word used in any language very often. It's a very specific, theological, biblical, scriptural word. Which means, well, first let's read it in John 1 John 2:2, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not of ours only, but also those of the whole world. So what in the world does propitiation mean? It is the satisfactory removal of wrath. Okay? Something like appeasement, but far greater. John MacArthur puts it this way. He says, propitiation is the exhaustion and satisfaction of God's wrath through the sacrifice of Jesus. So it satisfied the Father. It propitiated the Father. It satisfied all the need and requirement that his holiness had concerning judgment. Jesus took it all. He goes on to say, well, let me read again. Propitiation is the exhaustion and satisfaction of God's wrath. And I like how he adds the word exhaustion because he exhausted it all upon Jesus. Nothing left over. It was sufficient. The exhaustion and satisfaction of God's wrath through the sacrifice of Jesus. He goes on to say, Christ died as God, was sent from God to satisfy God. Isn't that interesting? And the only way that can be is that we have this marvelous thing that we call the Trinity. A term meaning that God is three in one. So you can have the fact that Christ died. He was sent, Christ died as God. He was sent from God to satisfy God. And that's why Paul can say in Romans 8:1, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now I'm really tempted at this point to pick up the pace, but I got to pause here. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. This is the most powerful freedom, giving, deliverance, not only receive, but experience God's forgiveness, verses in all of Scripture. I can't tell you that over the 30 years of ministry, how many times I have seen this verse wash over people and make them clean and set them free. Because they feel condemned. Because what dad did to me, what dad said to me, or what so-and-so did, said, all these different things, right? And we feel dirty, we feel, you know, that we are wrong, and it's all my fault, and all these things where we get layers and layers and layers of condemnation. But if you know Almighty God and He has set you free, you are free indeed. It's because here, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And I'm telling you, even though the vast majority, if not all of us in this room, know God, the vast majority of those people that I have seen, in a sense, set free are believers who are still bound up in their own sin or the sin of another that was perpetrated on them. And so that's got to be some of you. And to some extent, we rarely, if even ever, I guess, utterly set free, right? In a sense, because we have our sin and we continue to have, you know, sinful thoughts and behaviors and attitudes and various things. And so there's always a certain degree of bondage within our own just uncleanness. But and so really this is for all of us, but especially for those of you. And the ones whom I have seen in this greatest of bondage have often been those who have suffered abuse in their life, often by a loved one, or some sort of repeated bad behavior. Whether it is condemning, ridiculing, belittling words virtually 24/7, or whether it's physical or sexual abuse or whatever it might be at the hands of often a parent or a sibling or an aunt or an uncle or a grandparent or someone, and it is pierced you so deeply that it seems virtually impossible to be set free. Man, if you don't know Jesus, Jesus loves you to the point we've been talking about for an hour, and He can set you free. If you know Him and you're still in that bondage, know this. It isn't that there is salvation in Jesus and you might just barely eke it out. You might suffer from depression and anxiety and fear and panic and self-hatred till the day you die. Oh, yeah, there's salvation in Jesus, but no, this says there is no condemnation. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Let that wash over you. Let that become something that is a reality to you. Not just, oh, well, maybe it's a truth, but sometimes we got to come to other truths as well. You know, oftentimes we were children when we were abused, and so somehow we think, I'm the bad person. I'm the defiled one. It was my fault. Somehow I brought it on myself. Those are all lies. The adult that did these things to you is the bad guy. So you got to sort that truth out. Because if you think the truth is there's something bad intrinsically wrong with me, that's a lie. And you will be in bondage to that lie. So you got to embrace the truth. No matter how much I want to love daddy or whoever it was, that he is or was the bad guy. Evil, wicked. And that truth will help set you free, okay? Not listening to the lie. But the truth here is, and beyond, is there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now, I had no intention of pausing there. I was just going to go right through that. I just got to trust in the Spirit of God that even there is just one of you here or later watching, it's all worth it. We sang that song by Charles Wesley today, "And Can It Be?" That was a request of mine. And the first verse says, "And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain? For me who him to death pursued? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?" Man, if I had a better voice, I'd sing that chorus for you. Now, there are other prophetic details in this chapter that we're not going to look at today. Central to everything else, however, is the all-encompassing foundational truth of, okay, here we go, the Savior's successful, satisfactory, remember, satisfying, substitutionary suffering, one more, sacrifice. You can even find a way to fit in servant there somehow, but the Savior's, he is a Savior, Messiah Jesus. He was successful. He accomplished what he set out to do. He was satisfactory in the sense of particularly to satisfy the Father in terms of the propitiation for our sin. Substitutionary. Now, we haven't spoken a lot about that. It's absolutely critical. The substitutionary atonement. Substitutionary, meaning he substituted himself for me. Just before I'm about to be flogged and crucified, that he says, "Stop! I will be crucified in Kelly's place." Now, Kelly can be a fool and say, "Oh man, thanks a lot, but I got this." Or I can say, "Oh, you can't be serious, first of all, and yes, thank you. And then what else would you do for somebody who did that? Even a mere man, you would, if somehow they were able to survive it, you would worship them, you would follow them, you'd be indebted to them, you'd be devoted to them." Substitutionary atonement. We use that word atonement. It's the sacrifice of Christ by which he paid the full penalty of our sin. And I'm going to finish by reading a few verses from the New Testament. 2 Corinthians 5, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God." 1 Peter 1, "You were ransomed with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot." He himself, 1 Peter 2, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds," right, "his stripes, his scourgings, we are healed." 1 John 2, "He is the propitiation of our sins, and not of ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." And here in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 7, "Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth." And in light of all of this, now this has been long today, it's a lot. There's one section, trying to treat it all together. This next question is of the utmost importance. Of all that has been said and read today, how will you and I respond? How will you and I respond? Maybe something a little bit like this. Romans chapter 5, 11 to 14. Then I looked. Did I say Romans? Revelation 5, 11 and following. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, and the living creatures, and the elders. And the number of them was myriads and myriads, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And every created thing which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all things in them I heard saying." So this includes you and me. "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and dominion forever and ever." And the four living creatures kept saying amen, and the elders fell down and worshiped. Father in heaven, Lord God, you are good. Lord, I thank you. How can we even really adequately thank you? For you had put into motion such a plan and you had a driven motivation of your love that compelled you, and your holiness that required you to pour out the wrath that is due us upon yourself, your Son. How could you possibly deliver us from the eternal consequences of our sin and guilt while at the same time maintaining your own unblemished holiness that demands judgment? We have seen it here. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that the absoluteness of your holiness and the motivation of your love mingled together to give us the scene in Isaiah 53, to give us the cross. I thank you that it was so much your pleasure to love us, that it was somehow your pleasure to crush your own Son. Thank you, Lord God, for the satisfactory substitutionary atonement through the suffering and sacrifice of Christ. May we respond in worship, as we read in Revelation. May we respond in obedience and submission, which is our requirement, that we might live in you, through you, for you. Oh, thank you, Lord. I ask all of this by the authority that you have given in the name of Yeshua, in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
All right. Please stand with us as we close with the song.
Are the feet of him who brings good news, announcing peace, proclaiming news of happiness. Our God reigns, our God reigns, our God reigns. Alive, God loves. reign.